Hey, it's your bud. I'm making a video on the difference between the John Carter of Mars series and the Gore series, specifically book one. If you don't know, John Carter of Mars, The Princess of Mars is the first book, and it was published in 1912. That's right, the story series is over 100 years old. And now we also have Gore. Gore was put out in the 60s, and it's a little different. The titles and the pictures should give you a good hint about the difference in the story. The Turnsman, Outlaw, Priest King, Nomads, Assassins, Raiders, there's Captive, Hunters, Marauders, Tribesmen of Gore, Slave Girl, and Beasts. And that's all that I have of the Gore series. And there is Princess of Mars, Gods of Mars, Warlord of Mars, Thuvia, Maid of Mars, Chessmen of Mars, that's one of my favorite. Mastermind of Mars, another really good one. Fighting Men of Mars, I mean, they're all awesome. Sword of Mars, Synthetic Men of Mars, Lana of Gathal, and John Carter of Mars, the 11th book in the series, which gives it the series name. This is the Barsoom series, that's the name of the planet in this book is Barsoom, and this is the Gore series, that's the name of the planet in this. So, in this book, John Carter gets to Mars, also known as Barsoom, and in this one, the main character, Tarl Cabot, we'll just call him TC, and we'll call him JC. So, TC gets picked up by slaver things, these giant space bear things, and so TC gets picked up and taken to the twin planet of Earth. It's on the exact opposite side of the sun from us, so we never see it. And it is called Gore, and it is a land full of, well, more barbaric things. These are basically just two isekai stories, but they have sort of different styles of writing. One of them is the, oh yes, you are the princess of Mars, and I will fight for you. And the other is slave girl versus marauders and hunters and captives. It's just the exact opposite story. So in one of them, you have full-on respect for women. And the other one, it's world's slaves and beautiful women of human domination by the alien, secret priest kings, and it was also the world of Telena, tempestuous daughter of the greatest warlord of Gore. She waited for the man that would subdue her, the man who would be her master. But was Tarl Cabot that man? So yeah, in this world, don't you know that the most powerful and beautiful women are just waiting to be subdued by a man? So completely different styles of writing. I was gonna come up with some comparison or some name, but I think it's better if we just say, like, she's Helen of Troy. She's a slave girl, even though she was, what, daughter of the most powerful warlord or something? That doesn't matter in Gore. Sorry, women. Why did I say sorry? Obviously, in the story of Gore, it's what they want. Don't take me seriously at all. Do not take me seriously. Don't quote me. Let's see if I can find a good passage about the respect that they have. So, talking to Deja Thoris, the Princess of Mars, he asks her if she has a lover, and she was silent, nor could I venture to repeat the question. The man of Barsoom, she finally responded, does not ask personal questions of women, except his mother and the woman he has fought for and won. And then he's like, but I have fought, and then wished he hadn't said anything. So it's immediately like, this is a man who's trying to actually build an actual relationship with a woman. It says, I was hurt, but even then, John Carter, I did not repulse you as I should have done until you made it doubly worse by taunting me with having won me through combat. So that single boast that he stopped halfway through, he's like, that's him taunting her. I mean, obviously, in reality, that's really good that the princess is calling him out on this. But he's all like, I do not need to ask your forgiveness, Deja Thoris. You know that my fault was of ignorance of the Barsoomian customs, but I failed to do through implicit belief that my petition would be presumptuous. And okay, then he goes on and on. He's totally caught if he's pulling out words like that. Completely different styles of talking to people. And this one, once he gets called out, he starts going into like these long narratives of, oh no, my honor and this and that. My honor could never permit me to offend and you, princess. And this one's like complete opposite. Let's find some quotes. We can probably start with chapter 8. I acquire a companion. He doesn't find one. He doesn't like, doesn't make a friend. He acquires. Yep, we probably found the right chapter. So immediately in the very first paragraph of chapter 8, this girl gets stripped of all her clothes and Tarl is like, what's going on? And of course, obviously, she already likes it and unresisting extended her wrists and blah, 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 blah. And the bracelets and lights, they talk about the beauty and all of this and that. And how she's stolen. I'm the one who stole this, the home stone, says Tarl. Tarl's like, wait, I stole this home and now I have women. And then immediately he says, release the girl. Hey, good Tarl, you're not completely corrupted yet. She has done no harm. She did her best to save the home stone of your city. Hey, would you look at that? A sacrifice? What? No, they're gonna sacrifice the girl? No. For the priest kings? Sacrifice for the priest kings? Interesting. So despite how the world treats women, Tarl at least seems to have some morals at the moment. Wonder how long that lasts. I know partway through he goes like complete evil. I'm not sure where he goes complete evil. I think somewhere around Raiders, bad stuff has just continuously happened that Tarl is like, he just gives in to like the madness of the world. Both series, Gore and John Carter, have people starting from the very, very beginning. Alka. I have begun to learn the Gorian alphabet. And then Princess of Mars, I learned the language. So as you can see, both characters have to go to a brand new world where they're surrounded by aliens and they even have to start from square one and learning the language. It's just great when two books treat things seriously like this. These are kind of the best isekai. Which ones nowadays have people actually putting in the time to learn the language? Like, if he's learning the language in this book, then he's mastered the culture in this book. And also the same here. Once you learn the language, you can start, you know, taking over the whole world. And that is basically the plot of this book, is Tarl Cabot takes over the world, and then John Carter saves the world. I'd like to point out the abundance of really, really good sci-fi, and even just the pictures. So this one's got a good sort of swords, but it's also got, like, space shuttles. Got really cool landscapes, multi-armed animals. Got, like, duelers. It's got this whole society of, like, this history of the science. Landscape. Really, really awesome creatures that you get to fight. Sometimes we have to fight them barehanded with swords. Sometimes it's with space laser guns like this. And sometimes you have a good friend to fight with you. Synthetic men. That's a pretty interesting idea. But then these two don't look very synthetic. Maybe they're the synthetics and he's not. Swords of Mars, we have these flying ships that sail on basically air, which is really, really, really cool. And one of the coolest things in the story is some crazy scientist who invents two things. So there's paint, and when you paint it on something, it turns invisible. So you can paint your ship invisible. Or the other thing is these two kinds of beams. One beam, when it hits something, disintegrates all wood, and the other beam disintegrates all metal. So can you imagine just firing one beam of metal disintegration that gets rid of all the screws? Or just one beam of wood disintegration that gets rid of all the planks on these flying ships? There's awesome giant monsters. It's a really, really cool series. Then Gore as well has many different, like, cool monsters, these rideable beasts and things like that. Basically just, it's more savage. But there's also cool aliens and secret societies. As you get more involved in the stories for both of these, we get to be brought more and more to secret societies, ancient things that are left over from possibly aliens and things like this. There's all of these mingling of different cultures and species, and it's a really good mix. So even in the Gore universe, there's always new creatures to be tamed, new allies to be made, new monsters to be found, new aliens to be seen, and of course, new women in every single book. The Mars series too, we of course have Thuvia's got her own book, which she's introduced as well. The story of Gore revolves a lot around the citizens of Gore enslaving people from Earth, bringing them over to Gore, and then just basically leaving them to run amok. These giant things are cool. They remind me of the monsters from Attack the Block. They're like giant space gorilla bears that dual axes. Pretty cool, and also like women.
And then I'm gonna cover this up. You'll have to imagine a different face there. I can't find a picture of one, but there's like, well, I can find the pictures from the John Carter movie, but I don't really like those. There are these giant white apes that are just these huge, like, scary creatures.
And so there are giant apes in both series. That's a pretty interesting parallel.
In the John Carter of Mars series, there is a race called the Tharks, which are, if you've seen the movie, you'll see them represented. They're green, and they have four arms. And the Tharks are kind of the barbarians of this world. Gore also has lots of barbarians. There's another parallel. Both John Carter and Tara Cabot, when they're brought into these new worlds, they're not like, oh, you are the prophesized one said to do this and that and this. They basically, their stories are the result of their actions, which makes it just so much better when there's all of these books to go through. And by the time you get through all of those for John Carter and all of this for Gore, you realize just how much agency they've given the characters. These are both really, really good series for the amount that the characters get to choose their own future, but also affect the world in a realistic way, but not like you are the prophesized one, but they can also be important as well. They can make a big difference. And yeah, this one has some secret society of aliens that you eventually get to meet partway through. I mean, they're not secret society, they're just those slaver things have been capturing everything. So there's like multiple different alien species on this planet, and they all have their pocket of safety. And as well, there's all of these chessmen and synthetic men. And where do all these chessmen and synthetic men get their orders and creation from? Obviously, more secret society stuff in the John Carter series as well. So as great as these books are for the science and for the story, they're basically just two isekais where you have a princess or a slave girl. Princess isekai or slave girl isekai. And this guy's more of a barbarian. This guy's more of like a warrior. I know that barely makes a difference, but it kind of does. She's basically like Helen of Troy, where wars are being started over her because she's so amazing and everyone wants to win her over. And then she's basically just a slave girl. This is basically a hero isekai series, and this is a villain isekai series. So depending on what you're feeling like, you can read either of these book series. They are both filled with completely crazy ideas, unique monsters, aliens, space, swords, everything you want in a good series. Check them out.